Hey guys, this is David Kwan here. Bioshock Infinite is finally out, and it looks really awesome. I unfortunately don't have the capacity to play it. My PS3 is still in the YLD state, and I still haven't fixed it. That's going to cost me some money, which I don't currently have. And the only other platform to play it I have is a MacBook, which the specs are so low, it can barely play anything, let alone something like Bioshock Infinite. And it's also a MacBook, which is Bioshock Infinite is not available on this platform. So, because I'm not able to play it, I've been watching a bunch of like let's plays and playthroughs on this. So it's interesting to know, but I haven't finished playing it. So not going to talk about Bioshock Infinite here. Instead, what I will talk about is the grandfather of Bioshock Infinite, which is the original Bioshock. And some can say that the grandfather of Bioshock is System Shock 2, but I've never played that game. And that game is another thing in a different matter, but I think Bioshock is important to talk about because its impact it had on the gaming landscape as a whole. It's made quite a big impact, although maybe not as much as people think it did. Because for the most part, a lot of the games are still the way they are, but how much did things change in the gaming industry after Bioshock? That's kind of the interesting question to explore here. How much impact did Bioshock actually have? And that's not to say Bioshock is like totally responsible for this, because Bioshock does continue on the tradition of something like Half-Life 2. The way those games tell their stories is very similar. No cutscenes, but utilizing like what the character sees as kind of part of the storytelling. So in both those games, you control a character in first-person view, and the character doesn't talk, is totally mute, and you kind of just go around the world, and seeing that world in front of you is the game's method of storytelling. And pretty much Half-Life 2 does that, Bioshock does that. Half-Life 2 utilizes the character Alex Vance always on your, you know, surrounding your side to kind of tell the story. But Bioshock, I think, is really important because the chatter is always there. In Half-Life 2, for example, there's so many silent moments, and the game has that lonely, desperate feel to it. You're going through this world, especially like that zombie place. I forgot what it was called, but never go to Ravenholm. Ravenholm, for example, that part of the level in Half-Life 2, almost no talking except through the preacher who is saving his congregation by killing the congregation that has turned into zombies. Whereas Bioshock is full of chatter. And I think that's one of the unique features of Bioshock. There's always someone talking. Some mad splicers talking at you. There's who's that character? I'm playing this game right now. This is embarrassing. Not Fontaine, but Atlas. Atlas, that's right. Atlas is constantly talking to you. And then you pick up these audio tapes, and when you hit interact button, it starts playing. And you're fighting, and you're exploring the world, and the audio tape is continuously playing in the background as well. Which is something like, it's a simple idea, but not a lot of games, even still, not a lot of games do that. And that's like one of the best ways to, I think, keep the storytelling going while you're playing in first-person view mode. Many other games are still stuck on this idea that, especially like shooters, that, hey, here's this environment, you turn the TV on or you click on the radio and it plays this. And the player has to stand still and just kind of listen to it or watch it happening. And that's kind of aggravating. So many games do this. Even back then, and probably even still, I can think of some examples. Fear at the time, which is a 2007 or 6 title, it did it by having like player comes to phones, answering machines. You hit the play button, and the player has to stand there, and listen to the answering machine. And most of the time, the dialogue in those answering machines are totally irrelevant to the game storytelling. Most of it is just random cursing by cussing and. You know, it pairs no importance to the game story, but to really, like, to listen to all of it, the character has to stand there. That was not a great design choice back then. It still is not now, and Bioshock kind of showed that. I feel like Bioshock I really wish it had made a bigger impact on that. If Bioshock made a bigger impact on that, that would have been awesome, because a lot of games, even afterwards, still got stuck on that idea. The example I'm thinking of is Resistance 2, Henry Stillman's radio. You know, you have to stand right next to radio and you can't leave there until you finish listening to all of it. With Bioshock, you have the audio tape and you simply continue listening to it as you continue to fight and explore. Simple concept, but it works. And Bioshock Infinite, it seems like, continues that. And it even explains how it works, because it has the new invention box machine, VOX. And that cassette tapes keeps playing as you keep moving forward. So that's something. Another thing is Bioshock isn't just a shooting game. It also incorporates a supernatural powers. You know, that like you can shoot fireballs or lightning, or you can control machines with these fire powers, which is pretty unique. So it had that like whole RPG aspect to it. You can kind of upgrade how much you carry. So it has that impact going on it. I think at the time, a game that did a similar thing was The Darkness. For some reason, that game didn't make as big of an impact as Bioshock did. But I think Bioshock as a whole is because of the unique awe of the game. This idea that a player has to be awed into the game's surrounding and not just put in there and just kind of just be like, whoa, this is the game world. I think that's one of the biggest impacts of that irrational games made on the scene. And that's, as I'm watching through the Let's Plays of Bioshock Infinite, I still feel that awe. And it's just like, it's amazing. It's been said that irrational games are world builders. You know, they create the worlds that are so, like, just jaw-droppingly, just puts you into there, immerses you into the game universe. And Bioshock is one game that really does that. You don't even start out in the game world. You go into it. And then you are introduced it. You are explained to it with this, you know, kind of a old school presentation method of like the projector kind of going over and Andrew Ryan's voice going over, like, you know, do the efforts and the sweats of man belong to the man? And no, says Washington, it belongs to the state. You know, there's that speech going on, and you see that presentation, and you're watching that as you're pulled into Rapture. That's an amazing concept, and I wish that also had a bigger impact. But the emphasis on the game universe and how you're pulled into it, the emphasis on that as a method of storytelling is a humongous impact that Bioshock had, I think. And just a twist in the beginning. Now, when we play rational games, we always expect that twist to happen somewhere near the end of the game. And this twist just like, whoa, what? You know, and that is also a humongous thing in Bioshock. And there's also like a thematic aspect to Bioshock that carries on. Bioshock in particular had a really strong thematic connection to Ayn Rand's Atlas Shrugged, or the concept of objectivism. You know, people only deserve what they worked hard for. That's pretty much, I know that's a simplification, butchering of the concept of objectivism, but there's that in there. And I think I watched some playthroughs of Bioshock Infinite, and it seems like it really goes into the ideas of racial superiority and racism deeply in Bioshock Infinite. So even seeing that real-world ties and thematic connection in something as mindless as the first-person shooter genre is a hell of an impact that Bioshock has made. I would like to see more games, even especially in the first-person genre, start doing these crazy awesome things. Bioshock didn't reinvent the genre. It didn't, like, you know, save the genre from doom or anything, because after all, first-person shooter genre is still, like, the most popular genre out there. It's still very enjoyable, still very mindless sometimes. It still has poignant moments. You know, even Call of Duty has a lot of poignant moments. But the fact of the matter is, Bioshock doesn't do this with, like, cinematic experience or cinematic storytelling. It does it by pulling you into the game's universe, showing you how this world is, and letting you explore that world. That's, I think, such an amazing impact of Bioshock. It lets you have crazy, amazing powers that you can kind of upgrade and kind of customize how you explore this world. And it has a twist that just connects you into the game's main thematic, main real-life themes that makes you think and just goes, whoa, what the hell did I just experience right there? That is some crazy shit. And I feel like that is overall like one of the biggest impacts it had. And of course, allowing you to continue playing the game with those audio tapes going in the background without having to pause or without having to stand around doing nothing. So you're always, it's always up to you whether you want to plow through the game or just kind of sit still or stand still and, you know, take in the game's universe. I think Bioshock does that so well. And even still, it's kind of not as common to see in many other games.